The first question is, you started to play the guitar when you were 12 years old.
11.
11?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
It's okay. The solo show is to go a little deeper into the catalogue and challenge myself by playing more songs from my solo records and try to make the show as colourful and interesting as possible for the audience, because if I sit there and just play, you know, Uriah Heep songs, old favourites, I don't think that's necessarily makes for an interesting show. I mean, it would be partially satisfying for the audience, but the idea is for them to get to know me a bit better and to get to know the music more intimately. I just look on everything as having a song in it, so the inspiration can come from anywhere.
Finger away from the viewfinder, that's the first thing you do.
Young Mr. Hensley.
Yes, sir.
Changing my strings. No, back to making tea. No, back to the telephone.
Ja, hvordan forventninger har du til konserten?
Jo, jeg tror det kan bli bra. En gammel helt som var ung og hadde langt år og kassettspiller.
Det er jo en gammel helt, en rockelegende som på besøk her, så det klart. Både jeg og fansen gleder seg.
For å si det sånn, man har jo vokst opp med Uri Heep og få det inn egentlig med morsmelka.
Absolutt.
Så jeg var på Elton John i forrige uke i Budapest, og det var det liksom litt annen setting, 12.000 og... Ja. Men det jo nesten samme størrelse. Og her det 250 knapp, så det blir stort.
My first impressions of everywhere I go are always based on the people. And after that, then I start to look at the architecture and the scenery and everything else. But the people are the most important thing for me.
Hello.
Hi.
Here we are.
This is Julian, the owner.
Hello. Julian. Welcome.
This is Steve.
Hi.
Julian.
Welcome.
What are we doing?
Nei, altså, Viken var jo inne og snakket med meg og sa det at han skulle komme til Grydefjord og spurte om jeg skulle fare på konserten. Og det hadde jeg jo lyst til, og så ble det litt prat om jeg kanskje skulle få han hit og gjøre noe stunt med det. Og da at folk og fans får mulighet til å møte han, som ikke skal på konserten kanskje, og har lyst til å spørre han og få autografen og treffe han. Og,
Thank you.
me.
Sure.
What?
I would be a happy baby if I was in one of those. Yeah.
You're welcome, man.
No problem at all. Of course, no problem. Come on, Marcus, let's have our picture taken. No problem, mum. All right. Where would you like me to sign?
Wherever you want.
Okay, then I'll sign here, because there's some space here. But everybody I've met so far has been really friendly and smiling and seemingly healthy and the worst album cover in history. There's nothing pretentious about this,
well,
right?
Certainly in
this. Yeah, but when it's okay, it's terrible like this, but when you drive Sunset Boulevard and you see a 40 foot by 20 foot billboard of it, you just
one mistake is that all it takes to same happy moment, shame can wipe out all that I've done right. And I try, how I try, still our love found a place to hide. And I try, God knows I try, still our love.
Song I ever wrote. Yeah, I do. I remember I was in a band with some friends of mine from school, and we wrote a song called Hey. Like, hey. And this was part of a talent competition, and we won the talent competition. And the prize was to go to Pi Recording Studios in London, and record 5 songs. But the condition was you had to have 1 original song. And so me and the guitar player sat down and wrote this song called Hey. And it goes, going, hey, when you're feeling low, hey, we know a place to go. Anyway, we went to the recording studio and we played all our songs with a very famous producer, actually, who was later married to a very famous English female singer. And we did that, and they said, well, thank you very much, it's very good, but not what we're looking for. And we didn't care because we were just excited at the experience of being in London and being in a recording studio and everything. And so it was like a real dream come true. And then it turned into a nightmare about 3 months later because we heard our song being played on the radio, and we didn't have any legal claim to the song, so we basically got ripped off there. But
have you ever played it later?
No.
Never.
No.
It was just
stunning here anyway, so I thought, should we just try it? Then we can see what the brain is.
Next hour's a different difference, still working on it. They're working on getting the difference.
That's better. See, that's much better already. I mean, even though it's kind of crude, but it's much better.
Yeah,
working
on
it. Okay.
We'll use that for now then.
Yeah, just use this for now. Yeah, because I can play like this, and I can just play like that.
So that height would be a little bit higher.
This height or a little bit higher would be perfect, yeah, no problem. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. I think that'll be fine. Does that sound butch enough?
Standing in front of me is a dad, father, and a 10, 11 year old kid. And the kid's obviously impatient, as all kids are in a queue. And he says to his dad, he says, "Dad, I thought this was meant to be fast track." And he says, "Well, it is, son." He said, "But this is for your security." And the boy turned around to his dad and he said, "Don't you mean my insecurity?" Isn't that great?
Yeah.
Smart little boy.
Yeah. No, I'm glad I got to fly during the golden days of flying because...
Me too.
You know, when we were with Warners, they had a deal with Pan Am. Where what we did was we bought...
Oh, it was Pan Am as well.
We bought full fare...
Economy.
Coach tickets.
Yeah,
and got an automatic upgrade to first class.
Yeah.
There was no business.
Yeah.
And then in first class on Pan Am...
Dining upstairs.
Yeah. 3 hours to have dinner.
Yeah, wonderful. China plates,
book your seat,
crystal glasses, Chateaubriand cut at the table.
Oh yeah, chilled vodka and caviar.
I can give you the media bad story of that.
I'm telling you, it was so great. It was such a thrill to fly in those days.
It was, absolutely.
Now it's a battle, but. I've changed the name of Alicante Airport so many times now. It's gone from Alicante to Helicante to Horicante to... It's just such a nightmare.
Call.
Ladies and gentlemen, Steve Weltman, my manager, my friend, my water bearer. Okay, it's coldish. Okay, who has a question? I'll take the first one. Why did I leave Blackfoot? Well, I left Blackfoot because... Actually, the day I received a call from England, I was living in St. Louis at the time, Missouri, and I received a call from England, which when I found out that David Byron died. And I kind of felt like, I don't know, I felt very strange about that because, you know, David was a very special person to me. And I certainly loved music, but I didn't want to die because of music. And I just felt like maybe it was time for me to really get out of music altogether for a while. So I just decided to quit. But there's another reason for it, because basically it was very difficult for me to be in Blackfoot. They hired me to bring their sound into the 80s and make it more modern with the keyboards and different songs. The problem was that after we left the studio and we went on tour, we were playing, all we saw was Confederate flags and Jack Daniels. And it's really hard in Blackfoot's music, it was really hard for me to play the Hammond, and it was a style that wasn't good for me. So I didn't feel 100% comfortable. I totally didn't feel good, so I just decided the best thing to do was to leave. That's all. Another question? Yes, sir.
You have the songwriting during our hit.
Yes, sir. No, David. David was a lot of things. David was a great singer. He was a great frontman. He was very unique in his own way. And it was great to work with him. But what, for me, what was special was David would take my lyrics and interpret them perfectly. So I would write things and David would sing them exactly the way I would have liked to sing them. I'll play some songs tonight, which I wrote basically for Uriah Heep and for David's voice. And I can't sing them the way David did, but every one of those songs is a tribute to his incredible talent. And I just miss him. I still write. I'm thinking about David a lot of times when I write, because I write certain phrases, certain words that I knew which were his favorite words and everything. And so, you know, I still think about him a lot. The other day I was watching a video of Ruff Diamond, the band he formed with Clem Clempson after Uriah Heep. And I was really sad. You know, I mean, it's so sad when somebody so young and so talented dies like that. I know he's not the only one, but it's just really sad. And it's even sadder because it wasn't necessary. When I think about the distance between us and how hard it is at times here on my own, then I think about your smile, about our love, and in a while I close my eyes. I'm not alone. Though my footsteps fall, my love won't ever stumble. Through 1,000 miles a day, my love won't tire. With each passing day, I pray that our love is here to stay. And I close my eyes and kiss you goodnight. Sometimes I whisper your name, or dream a while a lonely love game. All I'm trying to say is that I love you in my way. And though the days seem long, I'll soon be coming home. Yes, I will. As I leave my song, my heart remains with you, my love. There really are no more words that I can find. For my love, you are my life. You are the color in my sight. And as I close my eyes, you fill my mind. Sometimes I whisper your name, or dream a while a lonely lover's game. All I'm trying to say is that I soon be coming home.
I'll soon be coming home. Yes, I will. How did I?
Get out of the wilderness. You described it as a wilderness.
Yes.
How did you get out of that?
Good question. When I left Uriah Heep in June of 1980, I was in very bad condition. There were two things which were really bad. One was, first of all, I was addicted to cocaine, which was an extremely bad thing and probably the worst thing I've ever done in my life. The other thing was that my whole identity was so lost in the identity of Uriah Heep, I didn't even know who I was. So after a year of trying to solve the problems in England, I decided to move to America. And I had homes there and, you know, it was easy for me to be there. But it took me 12 years to finally kick my drug habit. And it took me a long time to really rediscover myself so I could just be me again and not just be on stage 24 hours a day. Thank God I was able to get rid of my drug habit and get my feet on the ground. But then I saw clearly that the place for me was in music, not, you know, in business or in the other things I was doing at the time. So I started to write songs again, and then I started to make records, and slowly I learned how to do my job again. I learned how to write songs, I learned how to make records, and now I've learned how to play live and so on. But it took a long time. Thank you.
First of all, I was writing songs and preparing to make an album. And I had a meeting with some people from the label, and we could see there's a pattern to the songs. And the idea came to sort of expand the concept of my book and write songs which would tell the story of the life of a rock star in the 70s. So we decided at a very early stage that we would use a lot of different voices for two reasons. First, because I'm not a great rock singer. And secondly, because there were a lot of wonderful singers around in the 70s and we wanted to give a lot of different colors to the songs. And so we chose Jorn Lande, we chose Glenn Hughes and John Lawton. Basically to come in and give their character to individual songs, which would in turn give more character to the concept. It took a long time to record because I was still doing some writing while we were recording, which isn't the normal way I do things, but it took a long time. And I always say that with this particular album, I'm 99.9% happy. And I never had a record in my whole life that got such amazing critical response, positive response. And that was also 99% positive. I've never had that in my life before. So.
Do we have any requests?
Yeah. Cold autumn Sunday.
Sorry?
Cold autumn Sunday.
Cold autumn Sunday, huh? I don't know if I can do that one. I think I have it in my book. I'll play you a little bit of it, okay? Thank you very much. Thank you for asking for that. I'm happy I had it in my book. You know, I have my book with me because I there's a lot of songs and I can't remember all the words, so, and I don't want to get it wrong, so.
Sit down and try to pick the song everybody comes to hear and then add a few other things in there. Like last night, the show that I planned was changed a couple of times because of a request from someone in the audience, and because right before I went on stage I decided to add another song. So it's sort of spontaneous, and a lot depends on the first 10 minutes when I see how the audience is reacting to what I'm doing.
Do you have your songbook? Yeah. Okay. Unfortunately, I've changed a few things. I always do that because when I get to a room and I kind of get the atmosphere in me and I change things. But generally speaking, you can follow most of the songs in here. So
we know, but I'm not sure everybody knows, but in your band now, you're using Norwegians, musicians, and Eric from Iceland. Any reason for that?
Well, yeah, the further north you go in Europe, the harder the musicians rock. And Norwegian guys rock. I live in Spain, I work a lot with Spanish musicians, but they play rock in a completely different way, and it's foreign to me. These guys play rock and roll the way it should be played. And apart from the problems Eric has with his volcano, everything usually goes quite smoothly.
I'm gonna sing a song which I recorded. I think I recorded this song on an album called Running Blind, but I'm not sure. Why are you laughing? I can't remember all this stuff. I've written about 350 songs. I don't remember where they all were. But anyway, I just decided tonight to put this song in the beginning of the show. And it's a song which most guys would like their ladies to believe, but which is actually not true at all. We'll talk more about that later. And whatever record it was on, I'm sure somebody in the audience will know, and I'm sure you'll tell me. And because most of the time, when I'm doing these shows, people in the audience know more about me than I do. So I rely on you for this information. Anyway, it's a song called I Won't Change.
Try to stay the same, and if you feel feel the difference is in what you choose to see. Some of those changes are a little too hard for me, so I pray my love will see me through. La 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 la.
Father.
You're gonna have a guide, so he will tell you all.
Oh, okay,
about it.
Fine.
He's the main man.
Fine. Okay. Hello. Hi. Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Steve.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
And my wife.
Hello. Nice
Hello.
To meet you.
Hello.
See
ya.
Yeah.
We want to tell them. Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah, okay.
Everything is ready for the
okay, I'm ready.
Let's go. Jo, men. Nå vi jo her.
It's Pluto, Donald Duck.
Pluto.
Donald Duck. Ken.
Yes. Okay, I'm sorry.
You have to take off the shoes.
Can
somebody
take
me?
Or the foot?
I have to put my foot in there?
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to put my hand in there.
Yes.
Oh, I have the world's ugliest feet. I don't want to take my... What are you looking at?
Wait a second, Ken.
What?
She's got everything here.
Camera.
Oh, it's going to be something for that.
Okay. No close-ups.
Here?
Here?
I can't even stand here. It'll be tört.
Translation, please.
Why? You have to make them a little dry.
Yeah.
And the hand at the center.
You'll think this is very funny, don't you?
That's great.
Okay, now what? Did you know about this, Wilman?
No, I mean,
you organised this, didn't you? You're behind this entire thing.
It's okay.
Okay.
Oh.
It looks like an animal's foot or something. It doesn't look like a human hand at all.
Your turn next.
Oh, yeah, come on. Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. Oh, excellent.
You horror.
Excellent.
Which foot? Yeah. I'd still be back to game at 5 o'clock. You don't just stay there.
Yeah.
I have small feet.
You noticed I'm much, much better balanced than Ken.
Now you're on a hand, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. Here?
Nej, då vi fick förspörseln ifrån kommittén som jobbar med Ken Hensley och det upplägget I Gryllefjorden så Så ringte hun Hege I kommittén da, og spurte om det var mulig at han kunne komme hit og få oppleve dette her, og eventuelt komme I den støypen som vi hadde her. Og vi ble jo så overrasket, og vi syntes det var så svært og digert at det var nesten vi ikke trodde på historien om det. Så, men da det ble endelig avtalt og klokkeslett og sånn, så Så vi sprang jo rundt her som noen hauløse høns for å få tingene til.
Outstanding.
I was not expecting
Outstanding.
That.
Fantastic.
I think I might have to buy it. They've got some great paraphernalia in here.
Have they?
Yeah.
One more question? Oh, two questions?
What's your first impression of Norway, Senja and
Gullesfjord? Of Norway and what? Ah, okay, yeah, yeah.
Number two,
good, because I can't remember all that anyway, so. My first impressions of Norway have always been that it's the most beautiful country with the worst roads in the world. But it's really worth it because as I've traveled around here, many times in my life, I've always appreciated what a wonderful, beautiful country it is. But the way I measure everywhere I go in the world, wherever I go, whatever country, whatever city, whatever, my first measurement is based on the people, because that's the most important part of it. The architecture's great, and the buildings and everything, the lakes and the mountains, but the people are the first thing. And here I've always had such incredible, great relationships with audiences, people I've met, people I've worked with, and that's what means the most to me. And so look at us tonight. We're in this room, we're having a great time. It's not possible to do this everywhere, you know. But here, I have no problem. And as far as, I didn't even know I was on an island. We just went over a bridge and I said, oh, nice bridge. And geography was my worst subject in school, so. You know, I mean, I've had some great experiences in Norway and I'll never forget them. And I always tell people they have to come here to experience it, because you can take all the pictures and all the videos that you want, but it's impossible to describe just how spectacularly beautiful Norway is. So you all are very lucky. You have a great country and it sounds very special.
Wow, look at that.
That's stunning. I bet there's some wonderful fish around.
And don't start talking about fishing, Steve. I don't do fishing.
No, I know you don't do fishing. I didn't say that.
I did go. I used to go when I went to Cabo San Lucas a couple of times a year. I used to go out fishing for marlin, and almost always caught one, because the guys driving the boats knew exactly where to take idiots like me, so we could spend our time and our money hauling a fish to the boat and then letting it go.
Wow.
But that's the extent of it. What my brothers used to do, and go and sit by rivers and streams and ponds for countless hours on end, soaked to the bone, frozen, with a little tin of worms. I just don't see the point. Unless it's to get away from the missus for a while.
Music's what I do. And I try not to focus on anything else. I try to keep my mind always focused on music, because it's obvious to me that's why I'm here. Inspiration comes from things I see, things I hear, things people say, things that happen. I think the key is my mind is always open. So I can steal an idea from somebody in a moment's notice. But I keep my little songbook with me. It's in my pocket, in my jacket pocket. I keep it with me and make notes all the time. And
I just look on everything as having a song in it, so the inspiration can come from anywhere. But my enthusiasm is unlimited at the moment. I mean, fortunately, I've got my health and my strength, and you know, as long as I have that, then I want to keep doing what I'm doing. There, it's not me that places artificial limits on musicians. It's something called the music industry, which says that when you pass 30, you've had it. But I don't understand that, and probably neither does Eric Clapton or Phil Collins. But you know.
I sat before the wise man in the autumn of my youth. I told him all the things I had to know. He said you have the future if you need to find the truth. And in his eyes I saw that it was so. So I came right out and asked him the meaning of life. And as he smiled I saw a twinkle in his eye. He said with all his years there's still so much he has to learn. And once again I saw that it was so. Keep on living, loving, waiting your turn. It's the only way to ease your concern. If you want to find the truth, be sure you don't give up too soon, or you'll find it easier shooting for the moon. Which way should I run? There's so many roads, so many ways to turn. I am like a blind man, lost in the sun. I wanna be like you, and be a wise man too. But I'm looking for an easy way to learn.
Valley about 40 kilometers inland from Alicante, and our house is in a very isolated location. And when we moved there 9 years ago, we took our Labrador dog with us from England, and just suddenly dogs began showing up at the house, and we began taking them in because they were abandoned. And then cats, and then chickens and rabbits and stuff. And then a couple of years ago, Monica was given some sheep and a goat by a local sheep farmer, and we allowed them to use some of our land. And this animal thing just became, it's something that Monica and I have in common 100%. We both love animals very much, and it just got pretty big. And it's also very expensive. So what we did was we established the charity, which is Esperanza Street, and it website esperanzastreet.org, as a way of trying to offset some of the cost of looking after all these animals, because feeding them and caring for them is not cheap. And we have some very good people from all over the world, from Australia, Ireland, all kinds of places, that help us out, and most of the time their donations cover the cost of looking after the animals. And then we have a friend who has a daughter with Down syndrome, and through that connection we started working with handicapped children a little bit, and just trying to give them a bit of encouragement and better quality of life. And so Esperanza Street has taken on a life of its own now, and so yeah, it keeps us very busy, but it's a very satisfying life.
And on top of that, you recently became a restaurant.
That's my wife. It's my wife's project.
My wife's going to see this and she's going to want it.
Yeah,
that's all right. Okay, I'm going
to fix that. A medium.
Maybe. Is there a medium out there?
I've got the coffee. Oh, tea. And there are. Yeah, there are.
Yes, the
trouble
he's got. Get a pair of these for Jose. They're really nice.
Yeah, I love
them. I just want to show them to my wife.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to play a song that I know you know, but you may not know the story behind this song, and this is a song I want you to sing with me, and I know you can do it. One time when I was on the road touring with Uriah Heep, and we were touring with an American group called Shanana, and we were all traveling together in the same bus, and we were playing first. So what happened was, at the end of our show, we had to wait on the bus while Shanana did their show, and then we loaded all the people and the equipment into the bus, and then we could leave. So it got quite boring at times. So one time I got bored, so I took my acoustic guitar and I started working on a song. And it was the summertime in England, which lasts about an hour. And I wrote this song, and the first line of the song, actually the first 7 words are true. They're exactly accurate, but the rest of it was just my imagination. And I took the song to the band, and we recorded it on the Look At Yourself album, and then it became the song that you know now. So you know this song the way it finished up, but now you're going to hear it the way I wrote it. And again, I do dedicate these songs to David Byron, who did such an incredible job of singing them for me. I'll be looking for you.
was looking for love in the strangest places. There wasn't a stone that I left unturned. Tried more than 1,000 faces. Not one was aware of the fire that burned. When my heart in my mind, in my soul, la 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 la, la. Stop it.
Later this year, you'll be releasing a new album, Love and Other Mysteries, is the title. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
I can tell you about Love and Other Mysteries. I can't tell you exactly when it will be released because we're working on very soon we'll start work on a rock CD with Live Fire. And that's going to be the main priority. But Love and Other Mysteries is finished. And it's really a collection of songs which I wrote over the last few years. And it's very different from Blood on the Highway. It's just a collection of songs with no particular theme other than the fact that each one of them touches the human condition somewhere. And I want to present the album in a different way because I wrote a short story for each song. And if people read the story, they can go into the song a bit more deeply. So it's an experiment in a way, but for me as a songwriter, it's very satisfying to be able to make the record the way I wanted to and let the songs be very come to life very naturally.
Thank you.
It's too cold. You understand me? Too cold.
Comment in the paper.
Uh-huh.
And they have put it on folk fest.
Folk fest?
Yeah. That's a
festival huge for the people.
To call it that.
Really?
Yeah. They were talking about it on the desk in the newspaper. The journalists were sitting there, like, blow them away.
Well,
I hope they got the newspaper on the desk.
So do I.
I'm going to the sunshine.
There's a little picture on the front cover.
Wow. Cool. What does this mean?
So, Ken, what do you think about the good feedback you got from the concert?
In the paper?
Yeah.
My little picture in the front? Obviously, it's great. You know, when I play, I don't play for any other reason than just to play and share the music with people. And when it's... when you get a reaction like this, it's obviously a very big reward. So, for me, it's great. I really appreciate it. It means my visit was worthwhile, and it makes me feel excited about coming back. But this felt to me like being here for these few days felt to me a little bit like the early days of the summer party. And so there's an element of sadness in leaving.
Sure, of course it is.
You know, it's not like a normal gig where you would just do the gig and leave.
But you know, this is the way we are.
And then a green waiver form, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this is it.
Oh, that's right. You can't go any further.
You can't? No. You got a ticket. Thanks so much for this one. Yeah.
We'll stay in touch.
We will. Yeah.
Mr. Bing.
Nice to see you.
Take care, man.
Yeah.
Our best to everybody back there.
Thank you.
We'll see you soon. Just thinking about what you want to do next
year. Thanks for everything
you
did. For a great job.
In the short time I've been in Guildford, I've met some wonderful people and been treated wonderfully, and it'll be really, we'll look forward very much to coming back at some point in time, and it's up to you to organise it so that it's when the sun's shining.
Yeah. Well, that's it.
Litt mye bråket fra publikum i pausa, men...
Fantastisk.
Helt fantastisk.
Fantastisk happening.
Jeg må ikke passe gitar, det er sånn det skal være. Masse bil og mye folk. Kjørt fra Hamar for å komme hit.
Kom fra Hamar, det genialt.
Det bra, det?
Ja, det
Hit til...